Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yeah, you can stand if you'd like.
Yeah.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we place ourselves in your presence as your children today. We give you thanks for the many graces that you bestow on us each moment of our lives. We thank you for the gift of life, for creating us. We thank you for the gift of your Son, who opened heaven for us. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit that fills our hearts, that gives us all your gifts. We thank you for the gift of Mary to be our mother, to guide us. I ask you today, pour forth your Holy Spirit on this room, on each of us. Fill our hearts, open our minds, that we might hear what you want us to hear, that I might speak what you want me to speak. We have one desire, O Lord, and that is to be united with you and to share our faith with others so that we can all be in heaven. I ask this in the name of Jesus through the intercession of Mary, and we can pray a Hail Mary together. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Okay, if my wife was here, she would tell you otherwise. She knows the truth. Just a little bit of my background, I think it might help a little bit as I tell. I'm going to tell a little bit of my own personal story today, because I think it's important that we all share who we are and how God works in our lives, because that's the truth that each of us know, right? So I'm going to talk a little bit about my conversion story, but before I do, a little bit on my background. I'm married, going to be 40 years in October. All right. She tried to leave me a number of times. I wouldn't let her. But I have four children, and I'm one of 10 children. My wife is one of 10 children. So we have about 120 nieces and nephews here in Sacramento who are married with children, and so I'm probably related to about 1,000 people or more. And I figured I had a son who became a priest, and since we know half the town, I can't get away with anything, so I ought to become a deacon anyway. Anyway, I was ordained last year, last June, so I've been a deacon just a short time. I'm still kind of a rookie. But I came back to my faith. I was away from my faith, and I'll tell you a little bit about that. I've been very blessed. I have a daughter who thought she was going to be a nun. She went to Notre Dame University, and she was smart, and she got a scholarship to go to Europe. And she's visiting different convents as she's studying. And she's studying theology in Austria at the institute founded by Pope John Paul. So I was very proud of my daughter. And anyway, she calls home one day and she said, "Dad, I met a boy." And I said, "I thought you were thinking about being a sister." She says, "Well, he's really great, Dad. He's a seminarian."
Oh.
And I said, "Well, leave him alone." And she said, "Oh, you don't understand. He's an Eastern Rite Catholic. He's a Byzantine Catholic." And I didn't really know that much. And I says, "Are they in schism with our church? Are they under the Pope?" She said, "Oh, no, they're in union with the church. He's Eastern Rite. And Dad, a married man can be ordained a priest." So I have a son-in-law who's a priest also. And he was able to come here. His bishop let him come here. He served for 5 years in Slovakia. My daughter lived there. They have six little girls. And he was assigned here to Sacramento, 65th Street, St. Philip's Byzantine Church on 65th Street, just by Hiram Johnson High School. So I'm very fortunate. We have interesting dinner conversations. I have a celibate priest and a married priest. And so anyway, I have the reason that I come and talk and do this is because I didn't always believe in our faith, and I was far away from it. And so I've been given many gifts in my life. that I like to share. And so that's what I'm going to do today, a little bit. Before I start, you guys are all catechists or striving to be catechists. And so I ask you, what is your goal? What do you each have as a goal? You know, if you don't have a goal, you don't know where you're going. I want you to think about this as I give my talk today. What is your goal? I was inspired today a little bit by the Mass, Feast Day of John the Baptist, and I was thinking of a story. There was, and it's a true story, a man who was a hitchhiker. All right, he was dropped off at a church. He asked to be dropped off at a church, and there was a priest. And he walked up to the priest, and he pulled out a gun, and he put the gun to the priest's head, and he said, "Are you willing to die for your faith? Are you willing to die right now for your faith?" And the priest says, "What are you doing? What are you doing?" He says, "I ask you a question, and I won't ask it again. Are you willing to die for your faith?" And the priest said, "No, I'm not willing to die right now for my faith." And he said, he took the gun, he showed there was no bullets in it. And he said, "Then why should I believe you?" And he walked away. Okay. We have a guy named St. John the Baptist who represented our faith, right? So what I want to ask each of you is, would you? And think about that as our talk, and we'll talk about it at the end. As my talk progresses, I want you to think about, do you love our faith? How are people converted? Are they converted by what you teach them and what you know and what you share? No, they're not first converted by that. What are they converted by? They're converted by their hearts. And they want to know, do you love me first, don't they? If you love someone, they will hear you and they will listen to you. And they're converted by what they see in you, right? They need to see something in you that is the object of their desire. They need to look at you and say, she has or he has what I want. I want to be like that person. I want to be joyful. I want to be full of love, right? Compassionate. I want to be kind. I want all these things. And then they'll come to you and they say, how can I be like you? And it's then that you share your faith, right? It's then that they're open to listen. So first and foremost, we have to become, all right, the object of the desire of others. And how do we do that? They asked Padre Pio one time. Padre Pio, one of the greatest saints, right? Many miracles. You guys know his life. He worked so many miracles. And they asked him one time, Padre Pio, how do you do all these things? You know, you read souls, you can do all these miracles, you pray and people are healed. How is it? And he said, I just allow Jesus to work in me. So that's what our goal is going to be, a union with Christ. And so when I ask you, what is your goal? I hope that it is, I want to be one with Jesus. Because that's our goal for all eternity, and that's his goal for us, right? Yeah, to be these little specks on this little planet in the middle of this universe that we are. We're nothing, but somehow God wants to espouse us, and he wants to live in us, and he wants to share his divine life. And so if we allow him to live in us, we radiate his glory, and everyone you meet will want to become a Catholic, right? That's our goal. Okay, that wasn't always my goal. So I'm going to tell you a little story. And along the way, the reason I tell my story is not because I like to talk about myself. I actually hate to. I was so far away, and God led me on this journey. And so as we go, I think it's important to remember that, you know, we do not receive anything unless we ask for it. God loves us, and he gave us our free will, and he's so humble. God is so humble that he does not infringe on our free will. And so what we need to do, we need to ask him for things. Well, I didn't know that. So anyway, I'll start off. The first thing is our faith. You have to see it in someone. So I'll tell you about my dad. My dad, we were a Protestant family, anti-Catholic from the Midwest. I'm the oldest of five kids. My dad moves to California, and he meets a man who is his boss. And my dad begins to know this guy, and my dad admired him. He was courageous, he told the truth, he was compassionate, he was tough and firm, but he was fair. And my dad had never met a man who had all these characteristics. The man was really a special, unique person. There was only one problem with him. He was a Catholic. Okay? And one day, this man, so my dad admired him, right? He saw something in him that he desired. And so one day this man came to my dad and he said, "I need to talk to you in my office. And we're going to have a conversation and we may never be friends again after this. But I'm going to take this chance." And my dad thought, "Oh no, am I going to be fired or something?" He wondered, "Did I do something wrong?" So they go in and the man looks at my dad and he said, "I just want to tell you that I'm a Roman Catholic." My dad says, "Yes, I know." And he said, "I represent the church that is the fullness of truth." Of course, my dad bristled at that word. We're kind of anti-Catholic Protestants. Not kind of, we were anti-Catholics. Catholics were going to the bad place, right? The Pope was the Antichrist, and Mary was the whore of Babylon, and, you know, we believed all those things. Catholics had embellished the faith, and they added to Scripture, and they have all these rituals that are crazy, and we worship Mary, and, you know, we believed all those things. So this guy says, "I represent the Catholic Church, which is the fullness of truth." And my dad said, he started to bristle, and the man says, "But I want to make a bargain with you. If you can convince me that I'm wrong, I'll quit and I'll join your Protestant church. But if I can prove I'm right, you have to become a Catholic. Do we have a deal?" My dad goes, how are we going to do this?" And anyway, this man gave my dad two books to read. And there were two books that were the conversion stories of saints. One was, whose name is above the door, Saint Therese, the little flower, right? She wrote the story of a soul about her life, her conversion, right? And the other was by Saint Augustine, called The Confessions of Saint Augustine. He gave my dad two books. Do you think a Protestant man from the Midwest had ever read anything that great? It was so profound that my dad was shocked. You know, the mysticism, the depth of understanding that he didn't have. You know, his faith now, he looked and it was so much different than the Catholic faith. It was so deep. And my dad and mom began studying and they became Catholic. They came home and told me, the oldest, and I cried. I didn't want to be a Catholic. I knew these kids down the street and they were Catholic and they were weird and I didn't want to be one. So and all my relatives were anti-Catholic, Protestant. And so I heard from my relatives always kind of whispering in my ear, you know, all the things that are false. Why did your parents do this? Oh, on and on, I hear this. And then I hear my parents and they put me in Catholic school and I began to learn. So I kind of had one foot in both worlds. So I grew up like that, kind of divided. You know, not sure that it's all true, and I love my relatives, and so I grew up that way. I went to Catholic school, went to Jesuit high school, went to the University of Santa Clara, both Catholic Jesuit schools, and as I went through those, I lost my faith, because they didn't teach the faith, right? Jesus is a good guy, be nice to your fellow man. They never taught me how to defend my faith. They never taught me to understand my faith. To give them credit, I wasn't probably listening as well as I should, but when I came to know my faith, I became upset at the lack of teaching that I got. And why do I tell you this? You're a catechist. I couldn't articulate my faith. I couldn't defend it to anybody. I couldn't explain it to anybody. I didn't know a doctrine. I didn't know anything. And so I was like a lamb led out into the world to the slaughter, right? So what did I do? I developed my own faith. I picked and I chose and I picked and I rejected and I did this. And so I thought that I was doing the right thing, right? I'm following my conscience, picking and choosing. And I didn't realize that I was setting myself up as my own God, or I was my own Pope. I was determining what was right and wrong for me. I was committing the original sin of Adam and Eve, all right? They picked from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. They wanted to decide for themselves what was good and evil, right? I want to be my own God. And I didn't know that I was doing that. And so many people in the world do that today. And so many people in our church do that today, right? They call them cafeteria Catholics, picking and choosing. But I was doing my best, and I didn't know better. And so I grew up, and we were poor with 10 kids, and so I wanted to make money, and I remember being embarrassed because I didn't have nice clothes and shoes and all those things. And so I had a desire to be rich and make money and be successful, and that was my goal. And so my goal in life was money, have a family, have kids, have everything, nice house, all these things. And where was my faith in my goal? In my list of priorities, it was down pretty low. I still went to Mass on Sundays, didn't always understand it, I didn't get much out of it. Did I pray? Sometimes. But I became a person of the world, right? And so who forms me? Somebody's gonna form you if you don't form yourself, right? We're supposed to be formed to our faith because we believe Jesus is God revealed, right? God made visible to us. But I didn't do that, so I was formed by the world. By the news, by magazines, by my buddies at work. I became formed like that, and what was I? I became malformed. And I became a product of the world, and I became a person who could lie and stretch the truth, and, you know, I was really a product of the world. I did things that were sinful, but if somebody looked at me, they'd see, oh, he's married, he has four children, he's got a nice house, he goes to church on Sunday. They would ask me, do you believe? Yes, I believe in God, sure. What was I? I was a nothing, and I became empty. And I began to search for fulfillment, and what happened? I started doing things with my buddies after work and began having too much to drink, and I was neglecting my family, and I began seeking pleasure in things, and I would take trips, and I would buy toys, man toys, you know, things like that. I was trying to fill this void in my life because I didn't know any other way, right? I thought I was doing the right thing. Did I pray sometimes? Yeah, sometimes. So. Anyway, one day, I don't know why, I got a pamphlet on a retreat, and the retreat said 5 days silence, total silence, right? That's the last thing I would ever do, but somehow it intrigued me. And now I look back and I realize that it was a tug from God, right? It was a grace, I didn't know it. But I just thought, gosh, I'm so busy and my mind is going all the time. Yeah, well, wouldn't it be great to have 5 days of just silence? And so I did it. I signed up for a 5-day retreat. Don't even know why. And I went, and it was terrible. For the first it was suffering. I mean, the first day I met with the priest, who was the director. In the morning, you meet with a priest, and he kind of gives you the outline for the day, and then you're silent all day. And he said, I want you to pray on this one chapter. This one paragraph. It's about that big. And he goes, and I want you to pray 2 hours today on that paragraph, 4 times. I go, I don't know if I understand that. 4 times. He goes, yeah, 2 hours each, 4 times. I go, 8 hours on a paragraph that big? He goes, yeah, I want you to pray. I said, okay. I thought, this is crazy. So I read the paragraph. I probably read it 50 times. I started sweating. I couldn't concentrate. My mind was wandering. I was just, it was terrible. The first day, it was like torture, and I wanted to get out of there. But at the end of the day, all of a sudden, I read it, and I go, oh my gosh, I didn't realize that it meant this. I think it means this. So I was excited to see the priest the next morning, and I said, gosh, Father, I read that thing, and it was so difficult, but I found this. Something popped in my mind. He goes, he smiled, he goes, good, God is working. I want you to do the same thing today. I want you to read another paragraph. And I go, oh no. It was hard, but it was easier. The next day, it was easier. And pretty soon, this was the first time in my life, I would think a thought, and I felt like God answered me. But I wasn't sure it was God, but I would like have these inspirations that were deep. And I started thinking, either I'm pretty smart or something's happening. And by the fifth day, I didn't want to go home. It was so wonderful. And so I said the last day, I'm sitting there and I'm feeling so wonderful that something different in me, I just began to have this desire to be different. And something filled me, different than I'd ever had. So I'm going to leave, and there, I go to the church to pray, and there's this nun, this little sister. She was probably 85 years old, and she's sitting in the church, the little chapel. So I go sit on the other side, and I'm kind of glancing out of the corner of my eye at this little sister. And I thought, oh my gosh, look at her. She's 80-something probably, and she's given her whole life to serving God. And I thought, you know, she's probably done 10 times more good than I have in my life. I thought, 10 times? That's only 10 days, right? She's given her life, and I've not given one day. I've lived for myself. Everything I did was, even though I loved my wife and loved my family and worked hard and all those things, what was I doing it for? It was a selfish motive for me, right? It was for me. And I didn't realize that. And so I, all of a sudden it hit me. I go, she's probably done 100 times more good than me. 100 times. And I thought, that's only 100 days. And I go, 1,000 times. Oh my gosh, that's only 3 years. She's been a nun for probably 65 years. I go, she's done 30,000 times more good than I have. I started crying. It just humbled me, right? I just thought, how is the world better for me having been in it? It really was for me only. Even though I tried to raise my kids with values, right? They weren't great values, but I tried. Even though I tried to do all those things, really everything was self-oriented. And so for the first time, I prayed this deep, deep start of my conversion. I'm going to give you the different prayers I prayed in my life. This first prayer, I said, Dear Lord, I want to be a better person. Help me. I prayed with all my heart. So I get home. We had 30 ice cream parlors in 6 states. I drove a Cadillac. I was young, right? I thought I was hot stuff, full of pride. I had everything, a lot of money. Our business was successful. My dad and I had started Leatherby's ice cream parlors, you know. So I was doing great. And all of a sudden, everything started crumbling. We had a lawsuit, we had a business failure, a franchisee, we got sued by a guy in Florida, we guaranteed his lease, I got a $2 million judgment against me and my dad. We didn't have $2 million in cash. All of a sudden we had to put our company in bankruptcy, and then the snowball started rolling. When we did that, then people stopped paying us the royalties. We had no income. We ended up having to put the company in bankruptcy and sell it. All those, everything we worked for was gone, right? They sue you for fraud. They say you misrepresent, right? The attorney sued for everything. We never defrauded anybody, but we got sued for fraud because they alleged everything. We had no money to pay for attorneys. My dad had to sell his house. They moved into a, you know, I had four sisters still living at home at that time. They were the younger ones. So my mom and dad moved into a house. They moved in and they slept on the floor in the garage with a mattress on the floor so the kids could have the bedrooms. Our life changed. And that we got down to one ice cream parlor on Arden Way, and I had to quit work. I mean, there was no money there, so I had to go get a job somewhere else. And our names were in the newspaper, and embarrassing. I'd go sit in church on Sunday, and I'd see people on the aisle whispering and pointing at me. What's he doing here? You know, they were sued for fraud, and so it destroyed my reputation. We lost our jobs, we lost our money, we lost our houses, and I kept saying the whole time, at least I have my family. I never once said, at least I have my faith, right? I didn't ever say that, because it wasn't in my priority list, but I said, at least I have my health and my family. And then I got injured playing sports real bad, and I could never play sports again. I had surgery and I hurt myself. And pretty soon I don't have my health. And I said, but at least I have my family. Then my wife came and she said, you're no fun to be married to. I don't want to be married to you anymore. I don't want to live with you. I'm embarrassed. We get these lawsuits in the mail. People serving us. I don't even know you. And you're unhappy, you're miserable. I said, well, I'm unhappy because life is miserable. All these bad things. She goes, I don't want to be married. So I didn't live at home for a period of time. How is my prayer being answered? Lord, I want to be a better person. What's happening? I didn't understand. So anyway, so I said, Lord, I prayed another prayer. It was a hard one. Lord, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Help me find my way. Can you show me? So here I am at a swim meet on Saturday afternoons. You know how they have those swim meets in a park and the kids go all day Saturday? So I go and there's a man there who I knew, but he had left his family. He had started drinking. I used to see him in the bars. He was falling off the bar stools. He'd been there all day. I would go after work to have a beer and he would have been there all day, and he was trying to, you know, pick up on the ladies, and I thought, oh boy, at least I'm not like this guy. He left his family. I didn't leave my family, but even though I was having troubles. So anyway, I see him at the park. Hadn't seen him for a few months. Last time I saw him, he was in bad shape. He looked like real old, face wrinkled, unhappy. And this guy walks up to the park and he puts out his hand and he says, "Hey, Dave, how are you?" And I didn't know who it was. I looked at him and he looked familiar. But I, you know how you see somebody you haven't seen in a long time and you're trying to place where you know them, but there's some familiarity? I said, and he goes, "Oh, I'm," and his name is the same as mine, "I'm Dave." I go, "You're Dave? This guy looked 20 years younger." So it was like a 40-year swing. He looked 20 years older. And I looked at him, his face was glowing, and he was so happy, and he looked content, and he had joy, and he has peace. I just looked at him, and I thought, what? And I asked him, "What happened to you? You look great." He said, "Oh, I went on a religious pilgrimage." I said, "Religious pilgrimage? I didn't know you were. What religion are you?" He goes, "Oh, I'm a Catholic." And he started telling me about this religious pilgrimage he went on. And as he told me, I wasn't in any frame of mind to hear it. And I started getting scared that I was going to catch what he had because he seemed weird. Right? So I started taking steps back kind of slowly, and I was nodding. I go, "Oh, I'm real happy for you. That's good. That's good." I was gone. And all week long, guess what I kept thinking about? His face. Him. Yeah. There was something different. You can't make that up. So the next week, next Saturday, swim meet, I found myself running around like a little kid looking for the guy. I wanted to know more, right? So I find him. See how conversion works? So I find the guy at the swim meet. I said, "Tell me more about this place. I want to hear about this." Even though it sounded so kooky, right? These miracles. And he said, "Oh, I brought a pamphlet that explains what I wanted to tell you." He knew, huh? So he gives me this pamphlet. I devoured this pamphlet. And I read it over and over. And it was placed over in Eastern Europe, communist country. So I went home and I told my wife. We finally moved back in together, but we weren't getting along too good. But I finally made money enough to buy a new home and move my family back in, but it wasn't good. So I went home and I said, "Let's take a vacation. You want to? And we'll go to this communist country." And she goes, "What?" You know, it just made her mad. So I said, no, it's it really. She goes, I don't want to go. And I said, "Would you care if I go?" She goes, "I don't care what you do." So I went and bought a plane ticket, and I was gone in a week. Flew to a communist country all by myself. Didn't even really know where I was going. I get there, and I witnessed many, many miracles, but they didn't change me. I start thinking, oh, they're Catholic tricks, right? Explain them away. You know, I'd explain things away in the natural order. I'd say, oh, that could have happened because of this and this and this. But I was witnessing all these amazing, amazing things. And finally, after being there 3 days, I got sad. 4 days. I thought, why did I come here? Oh, I forgot to tell you my next prayer. My next prayer, on the way on the airplane, right before, I said, "Lord, I want to know the truth. I want to know the truth. I've lived by my own rules, and I want to know, is there a truth outside of me that I don't create, that I can find?" Right? So I prayed that on the way. And so here I am, and it was beautiful. There's Catholics praying the rosary. There's masses going on. There's confessions. There's all these wonderful things. And that wasn't why I came. I wanted something in here, right? I wanted to know, is God real? Do I have a purpose? Is our faith real? What faith is real? Is heaven there? I wanted to know so bad. right? Your catechists want to know that. Or the children you're catechizing, they want to know that, right? So I had this deep hunger to know, am I important? Does my life have value? All of those things, right? I want to know the truth. So I'm depressed after 3 or 4 days because I didn't come to see a Catholic oasis. It was like a Catholic Disneyland there. 10, 20, 30,000 people from all over the world. It was really beautiful. So I'm standing outside the church one day and I hear American voices, English. And when you're in a foreign country and you're hearing voices from in every language, I kind of went over and I stood next to the Americans. And they were talking about going to the home of one of these young people who allegedly see the Blessed Virgin Mary. They were going to go to the home and they were going to talk to her. And I heard him saying this and I thought, oh my gosh, Lord, I wish I could go and see her. Because if I saw her, I would know. I'm a salesman, I'm a good judge of character, I know people. I'm going to look at her and I can tell she's telling the truth. I'm going to look at what she's wearing and how she answers, and you know, I'll know. And as soon as I said this little prayer, this lady standing right next to me, actually it was probably a teenager, she turns around, she looks at me, and she goes, hi, where are you from? I said, oh, I'm from Sacramento, California. She goes, oh, we're from, I think it was Cleveland, Ohio. I said, oh, that's great. She goes, we're going to see so-and-so. Would you like to come? I said, yes, I would. So we walk over, and I'm with this group of Americans. We walk over, and through an interpreter, this lady came out. She was so humble. She looked every single person right in their eyes. She didn't look down or talk. She looked at us with such love and caring. And she said the most profound things I'd ever heard. I hadn't heard things like this. It was so wonderful. And guess what she was doing? She was glowing like my friend. She was radiating. You know how sometimes you see people and they're happy, but then you see people and there's something more, right? Jeez, I just go, my gosh. And then somebody asked her a question. And this has always stayed with me because it really hit me at the time. And I hope you learn from this too. I've tried. Somebody asked her, how much do you pray? And I thought, well, that's kind of a silly question. How much do you pray? She smiles and she said, well, in the beginning, I didn't know how to pray. And it was hard. It was even hard for me to say 7 Our Fathers, 7 Hail Marys, and 7 Glory Bees, which was the custom in that area. She said it was hard. But she said, Our Lady taught me. And she said, now, she says, I offer my entire life as a prayer. I just go, jeez, how do you offer your entire life as a prayer? And it really just, it hit me so hard, I thought, that's what I want to do. But I don't know how. I don't know how. And so the contrast, this is a great turning point, the contrast between her and that beauty and that goodness and that truth and that love, and me, is night and day. I had compromise and corruption and lies and sins. I had been to confession for 20 years, right? And I just wanted to get away. I just took off running. And here I'm a grown man. I'm running across the field. I just didn't want to see anybody. I wanted to get away. It sounds kind of silly. And I went and I found a place where I could be by myself. And all of a sudden, I started feeling such remorse for my life, sorrow for my sins, that I fell down on the ground and I made the next prayer. I repented. Lord, please forgive me. And I think this is kind of the journey that every soul is on, right? Wherever you are in this journey, repentance is so important. You know, John the Baptist, what did he say? Repent and believe. What did Jesus say? Repent and receive the gospel, right? Repentance is so important. I'm involved in a deliverance ministry with my son. I'm going to talk about that after we take a break. And it's so important, repentance, because there is no healing without it. There's no healing without repentance. And you can always go deeper in your repentance, in your conversion. So this was the deepest I'd ever got. It was so hard for me, I fell on my knees. And pretty soon I'm on my hands and knees, and I am crying harder than I ever cried. I thought my insides were going to come out. These tears of sorrow and remorse, but at the same time, it was joy. It's hard to explain. It was like I knew there was truth. So anyway, I prayed my next prayer on the plane. Dear Lord, I've never kept the promise that I made, a New Year's resolution I broke every one. I've never been able to succeed at doing the good that I want to do. And so I ask you for your help. Lord, help me. I can't do it without you. So I get home, and my life changed. I had joy every day. I wake up, and I had happiness. I desired to go to Mass. I found myself at the office. I take off at noon, and I walk and pray a rosary. Would I ever do something like that before? No. But I just had this desire, and I had a hunger to learn the faith. And I think God gave me this gift because I couldn't do this before. I couldn't even understand a theology book, right? Anything. And I began to read, and I began to devour our faith and learn. It was so wonderful. It was a great time of grace. I probably read 300 books in 1 year. I don't know how many, lots, right? And so one of the things I read, every single time I would read a book on the life of a saint, it would come out glaring. It was like the page almost glowed, where Mary appeared to the saint, or Mary spoke to the saint, or the Blessed Virgin Mary inspired this saint and they dedicated their religious order to her, right? And I began to find in every book on the life of a saint, I found right in the center of it, the Blessed Virgin Mary. And, you know, in our times, kind of, in some ways, the Blessed Virgin Mary is considered maybe even an optional devotion for little old ladies who pray the rosary, that Jesus is the center of our faith, which is true. But I didn't realize that God puts Our Lady in the center because Jesus comes through her. God doesn't change. He came to us through her the first time. He continues to come to us through her, right? The Holy Spirit overshadowed her and Jesus was born in her, right? She was present when the apostles received the gift of the Holy Spirit. She was present at the Last Supper, right? She was present at the foot of the cross and he said, "Behold your mother," right? God put Our Lady in the center and gave her to us. And he said, "Behold your mother." And I began to realize how important the Blessed Virgin Mary was. So now I made my next prayer. I consecrated my life and my family and my wife. And I did a real intense thing. You know, it was one of those 33-day consecrations. I did that, and it was hard to get through. It was like somebody didn't want me to. And everybody I find that does it, they struggle to get through it. You know, there's always a desire to quit, right? Temptation to quit. But I did that, and miracles started happening in my life. My children began to respond differently. I found that I had a peace because I had given my family to her, so I didn't worry like I did before. I just trusted. It was really amazing. And my kids began to respond. I caught them early enough from going the bad direction. I caught them early enough and they began to respond. But guess what my wife did? It got worse again. I thought, I'm honest. I love her more. I love my family more. I have my right priorities. I'm a happy person. I'm better. Don't you see that? What did she see? She saw what I saw in that guy Dave, my friend. I don't want to be weird. What's the matter with you? You're weird. You're different. Our friends are talking about you. They say you're going to Mass every day. Why do you have that medal around your neck? People are going to think you're a religious freak. No, you're not going to put that crucifix in our home. People will come to our house and they'll think we're nuts. Right? We're not religious fanatics. That statue of Mary, you put it under the bed. I'm not having it in my house. All right? And it got worse and worse and worse. And pretty soon it was worse than before. Right? It was terrible. And I thought, what is going on? I didn't understand. right? I'm a better person. And finally, it got so bad, and I was so sorrowful, and I didn't understand, that finally the thought hit me. Maybe God wants me to live separated from my family, to atone for my sins, maybe. Maybe that's what he's asking, this great suffering. And I couldn't imagine it, because I kept praying for my will. I want my family, I want my wife, I want. What was I not doing? I didn't say the second part of the prayer. Jesus said, Lord, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but thine. So all of a sudden I realized, I'm praying for what I want, what I think is best. It just hit me so hard, and so I finally did something. This was my next prayer. I surrendered. I said, dear Lord, as much as it would hurt me, as much as I don't understand, as much as I think I know what's good for me, I accept your will. I surrender to you and I will trust you. And when I said that prayer, this burden just left me. I wasn't afraid. I wasn't anxious. I was free because I trusted, right? Jesus, I trust in you. I have a great story about Faustina and our family. I'll tell you that some other day. But it was the first time I really, truly surrendered. I never had surrendered before. I had partially surrendered, but I still always thought I knew what was best, and I prayed for what I wanted. So when I surrendered, guess what happened? The next day I went to work, I called the attorney, and I said, prepare the divorce papers for my wife. And I'm going to give her her freedom. She's so miserable, so unhappy. And I thought in my mind, this is what I was going to say to my wife. I was going to say, I'm going to give you your freedom. I don't want to be divorced. I want to be married to you. You're the only person I'm ever going to be married to. I will stay celibate the rest of my life. I will give you every penny I earn. I will take care of you. I just don't want you to be miserable and unhappy, and I'm going to give you your freedom if you want it. So I was going to prepare the papers, and I was going to sign them and give them to my wife. And that day I went to work, and my heart was so heavy. I couldn't pick up the telephone. I couldn't work. I just kept thinking, maybe this is what God wants. And it was hard to accept, right? Sometimes when you don't understand, and it was hard. So the phone would ring, and I didn't really want to answer it. Finally, they're paging me at work, and they're saying this guy has called a number of times. And so I pick up the phone, and it's a man that I met in a prayer group. And I didn't know him very well. I'd seen him around, didn't know him very well. And he said, can I meet with you this morning? And I said, no, today's a bad day. Bad day, I'm not feeling well. And he says, well, I really need to meet with you this morning. Can I just meet with you for a few minutes? And I said, really, no, today's not a good day. Because I had to go get these papers and give them to my wife. And he said, well, I'd really like to meet with this. And I got irritated with that guy. I said, don't you understand? Today's a bad day. Why are you so persistent? He says, well, I have a message for you. A message? Like, what kind of message? He goes, well, I wanted to tell you in person. I said, well, if I'm going to meet with you, you need to tell me. He said, well, he goes, you know that little prayer group you visited, a little rosary group that you prayed with a few times? I said, yeah. It was a young adult prayer group that I prayed at. I went and just visited. I was older than all of them, but I just visited. And they were all probably in their late teens and up to mid-20s. I prayed with them. And he said, well, there's a girl in that prayer group who the Blessed Virgin Mary speaks to her heart. She receives interior locutions. Well, I wouldn't have known anything about this if I hadn't gone to that pilgrimage, right? And I thought, but in Sacramento, come on. This is crazy. I was a skeptic always, right? And I said, really? And he says, yeah. And she was awakened in the middle of the night and asked to write something for you. And I have an envelope with seal. I go, oh my gosh. So I agreed to meet him somewhere where no one would see us. We went to a park, out in the middle of nowhere. I met him at this park. And so anyway, I said, tell me again what happened. He told me. And he hands me this envelope, and I open it up, and I'm going to just kind of paraphrase some of it. It said, my dearest son, it is your heavenly mother. I am writing to you through my servant, this girl. And I want to tell you, all heaven, sorry. You know what, I've told this story so many times and every time, emotional. But all heaven has seen your sacrifices and your yes. And God does not want your family divided. Your family has a calling. Have faith. Don't lose hope. Something like this. And then it told me things about myself that no one else knew but me. At least I thought nobody else knew. Only God, right? And I read this, and I don't know, if you believe it, it was a message from heaven. So all of a sudden, I didn't lose hope. And I thought, this is amazing. Is it true? Does heaven touch people like this? You know, I thought only special people got touched. And so anyway, guess what happened to my wife? Bad things began to happen to my wife. Amazing. You could just watch these things. My daughter was sitting on the floor, was curling her hair with a curling iron, and my wife reached up to take it, and the curling iron fell on her eye and burned her eye so badly they thought she was going to lose the sight in her eye. It was really painful. And then she had gone out to spite me and went out and bought a brand new Suburban that we couldn't afford. Just had this brand new Suburban in the driveway, and it was stolen, and we had no insurance on it. So she lost her pride and joy. And then she's at work a few days later, and she's closing Leatherby's, and one of the busboys goes out the door, and a two-masked gunman put a gun to his face and came in, made all the employees after work lie down. My wife was in the office counting the money, and they came in and they put a gun in her mouth. And they told her they were going to blow her head off, and she had to open the safe and give them the money. My wife, she wet herself. She was afraid she was going to die, right? So anyway, all these bad things, one after the more things. My wife was broken. She was so angry, so prideful, and now she is broken. And she told me, all I want to do is kill myself. I just think every day when I come home, I want to run my car into a pole and die. I think that thought all the time. By the way, that thought's from the evil one, always. And she said, and so anyway, we are sitting at the dinner table. She was so miserable, so unhappy, and I was so filled with joy. And she was, you know, I had this peace in me. And it's the start of Lent. And my kids are sitting around the dinner table, and if I brought up religion, my wife, the claws would come out, right? What are you doing preaching to everybody? So I took a chance, and I asked my kids, today's Ash Wednesday, or tomorrow's Ash Wednesday, what are you guys going to do for Lent? Are you going to make any sacrifices or give things up? And my kids went around the table, and they said, I'm going to give this up and this up and this up. You know, they're in Catholic schools. And I said, oh, that's great. And they asked me, what are you going to give up, Dad? And I told them what I was going to do. And then my wife goes, aren't you going to ask me? I go, okay, what are you going to do? And I thought, oh, no, what is this? She goes, I'm going to go to daily mass. And I said, oh. I was trying to catch myself from falling out of the chair. And I said, really? She said, yeah. She said, I have treated you so badly. You're always kind and happy, and I want that. So, women are tougher than men, you know that? Women, boy, they make up their mind, and they're tough, and she made up her mind. She went to Mass every single day, and this dark cloud started lifting from her. Every day she looked different, more and more and more, till finally it's Easter, and they had a communion. Excuse me, a penance service where they had 10 priests come in to hear confessions. So I tell my kids at the dinner table, I took another chance. I said, there's confessions tonight. And they all go, Dad, we went at school. I said, oh, okay, well, I'm going to go over tonight. My wife goes, aren't you going to ask me if I want to go? I go, okay, you want to go? She said, yeah. So as we're driving over there, she began to hyperventilate. Her face turns totally white. She's taking deep breaths. I didn't think she was going to make it. She hadn't been to confession for 25 years. Get over to there, and I just kept praying, "Dear Lord, give her the strength to do this. Give her the strength to do this." And she went in, and she had a wonderful priest. He was so gentle, and he told her that God was so happy. He gave her one Hail Mary to say. One Hail Mary for a lifetime of sins, right? Because, anyway, she came out sobbing, cried and cried and cried, right? So we're driving home, and I wanted to warn her that when you do something so wonderful, that the evil one does come and try to take it away in some way. He tries to take your peace, tries to interfere. So I tried to gently tell my wife, I said, you know, you've done such a good thing, and the devil will try to probably, you know, convince you that you didn't. She just goes, "Why do you have to ruin everything?" So I go, "Oh no." So, and I'm going to end my story after I tell you this, and see if you see this, the symbolism here. So in the middle of the night, I think it's about 3 o'clock in the morning, my wife jumps up and says, "There's someone in the house. There's someone in the house. I heard the door slam." The door slammed. My wife jumps up and she starts running through the house, turning the lights on, running around like a crazy lady. And I thought, well, if somebody's in the house, why don't you let me go? Why are you doing this? She's running around. She comes back. She sits on the bed. She just starts crying. She goes, "I just had the most real dream I've ever had, but I don't think it was a dream." And I said, "Do you want to tell me about it?" She said, "I was dreaming and I was back in my father's house." Okay, think of this dream. "I'm back home in my father's house. And the sky was so beautiful. There was these beautiful clouds and there were flowers everywhere in our yard. And I was with my brothers and sisters and my family. And I was in my dad's room. And all of a sudden I look out and outside there was hideous, ugly creature that was gray." By the way, she saw Mel Gibson's movie, The Passion of the Christ, and she saw that, and when she saw it, she goes, "That's what I saw." The devil, right? And she said he was outside the window and he was looking at me. And I didn't know what to do, and he came and he opened the door and he tried to come in. Right? And she said, "I didn't know what to do and I was so afraid. And then I heard this woman's voice. And she said, 'Don't be afraid. He can't hurt you. Just pray.'" So guess what her prayer was? So she said, "I looked down and there was this little ceramic object on my father's nightstand. And I reached down and I grabbed it." She said, "I held it. And it was a white ceramic lamb." A little white lamb. And she started saying this prayer. "Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb." She kept repeating it over and over. I don't know if she knew the Hail Mary, right? But that's still a great prayer, huh? So anyway, she said the creature began to scream when she prayed. And he reached up and he tried to take the lamb away from her. She said, "I wouldn't let him. I held on tight." And he got so angry that he slammed the door. And it was so loud that I thought it was our door slamming when I woke up. And she's crying. "What happened? What do you think? What do you think?" Do you see the symbolism there? Mm-hmm. Gone to confession. She's back in her father's house. Right? Isn't that beautiful? Mm-hmm. So anyway, my wife was different. We now have Blessed Virgin Mary statues in every room. Every pilgrimage we go on, we buy something. There are so many. They're in the closets. They're under the beds. We can't even put them all out. We have crucifixes. My wife has become a religious crazy lady. Not really. She is wonderful. She's a great spouse. She's my best friend. Our family finally became a Catholic family, where husband and wife are complementary. I realized that all the things I used to gripe about, she did. She was doing what she's supposed to. She's different. She's a mom. And all the things that she was unhappy that I did, she realized, I'm a dad. And we became a couple. And it transformed our children. And I think that's why I have a priest today, who's a son, and all the things that have happened to me in my life. And our family, it was so awesome. Not without trial. You know, we still have the ordinary things that you go through, the difficulties and things like that. But it is so different now. And I wanted to share this. So what was my next prayer?
Thank you.
Thanksgiving. Yeah. So anyway, I'm going to stop there, and then I have some other things to tell you. We'll take a break, okay? Okay, God bless you.